Good morning. Well, we're going to wake you up this morning, and I need a little help. Are you feeling like singing? If you'll sing along with us, we're going to sing Days of Elijah. These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call. Lift your voice and give to me, and out of Zion till salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, building a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide as the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun.
Welcome to worship this morning. A special welcome to those of you who happen to be guests this morning. Please know that you are welcome to participate in every aspect of the service, including communion. There's also a yellow guest card somewhere in the seat back in front of you, and I invite you to fill that out, return it to the welcome window across the way for a gift in exchange for that card at the conclusion of worship. There's also a prayer card in the seat backs as well. That prayer card is for anyone who has a prayer, either for yourself or somebody you might know that you would like prayed for. Just fill that out according to how you would like the prayers and put that in the offering basket. Communion is part of every single service at New Promise. And for communion, you are welcome to come forward by the center aisle, receive an empty cup if you prefer wine, and wine will be poured for you, or a filled cup that has grape juice. Take that, the gluten-free bread, and go back to your seat by the side aisles. There's also prayer up front here. This is the choir seats. The choir is not here today, but the choir seats are here, and there's prayer immediately following the service if you would like individual personal prayer spoken. Coming up this week, we have Guys Night Out, and I think we have Guys Night Out this week, and that is Thursday. If you're going, please contact Dana to let him know that you are interested in being part of Guys Night Out on Thursday dinner. And I'm not sure my mic is working, so is it? Maybe I just can't hear. Anyway, then we're going to return to two services next week. On the 8th of September, it's 8 o'clock and 10:30, so please note that on your calendar so you show up at the right time. If you show up at 9:30, There's going to be a training going on or a workshop going on in Luther Hall regarding innkeepers. And the innkeeper workshops will be going on the 8th, 15th, and 22nd. Innkeepers is part of what we do as a congregation. Everybody takes a role to help make sure the Sunday morning experience happens. And sometimes we forget what exactly that is. And so the workshop helps us remember and also gives you an opportunity to perhaps go out of your comfort zone into a role that you might not otherwise have thought you could do. So please consider coming to the innkeeper workshops between services the next few Sundays. Next Sunday also begins Sunday school. Sunday school is now returning to Sunday. It was on Friday. It's now on Sunday twice a month, first and second Sundays, from noon until 2. So if you have young people who are coming to Sunday school, please have them come be there at noon following the second service and have them bring a sack lunch that will start off the time together. Confirmation also begins next Sunday at noon as well. Coming up then for grades 1 through 5, there's something called Camp In. And that's an opportunity for the kids to actually camp in with tents in Luther Hall. And it's a lot of fun. We have s'mores, we have movies, we go to swimming. It's really a lot of fun. So if you have a child in grades 1 through 5, there's a sign up at the information desk. Please let me know that they are coming so we can plan for transportation to the pool. Coming up later in September are the grief and divorce care groups. These are beginning and they will be for 13 weeks. If you are interested, please go online and register at one of those websites, and that starts up September 16th. I believe there's a video on that too.
I'm Steve, and I went to divorce care at the September of 23, and you know, it had been something, I was divorced 2 years before that actually, but I never really worked through all my issues, and by going, it helped me follow a routine, and the discussion was really good for me. And you know, after 3 months, I really felt like it helped me to reground myself. So it was really worth it. I appreciated all the help and the whole community.
Thank you. The last Sunday of the month, New Promise will be having a special meeting of the congregation on the 29th. At 9:20, that's an interesting time, 9:20, there'll be a special meeting of the congregation to discuss the continuing resolution on undesignated gifts. There will be food, so please come and participate in that very special meeting of the church on the last Sunday of September. Promise Discovery is happening this 22nd and 29th. This is an opportunity for you to come and learn more about New Promise. If you are just wanting to learn more about New Promise, if you would like to consider joining the congregation of New Promise, this is also an opportunity for you to come and learn more so that you might discern if this is a congregation you'd like to be part of in a membership way. So this is September 22nd and 29th. There is a sign-up for that at the information desk since there are materials to prepare. So if you would please sign up and indicate if you are interested in attending that class. And then finally, last weekend, the confirmation kids and I were at Lutherwood, and we had a retreat. And one of the things we did as part of that retreat was give back to Lutherwood, and we refurbished their outdoor worship space along with a number of people from New Promise who came just for the day just to help with that project. And you can see some of the slides to show the work that we had done. It was really wonderful. There's a frog, okay. It really was wonderful that we were able to provide them that renewed space. Lots of frogs. Sure, there's the space. Those are the benches that we redid. And I want to thank all who came to do that and thank the youth for their hard work. So that's it for our parish notes. I invite you to stand as you are able and to face the font for confession.
We confess our sins before God and one another. Let us pause to remember those things for which we need forgiveness. Merciful and holy God, you have called us to follow you in the way of justice, mercy, loving kindness, and care for all the earth. In our human frailty, we have turned away, letting our fears drive us to actions or inactions that cause harm to ourselves, our neighbors, and our world. Draw us back into your loving arms. Wipe away our fears and our mistakes, that with clean hearts we might live to serve you and all of creation. Hear this word of hope, beloved children of God. Our God is rich in mercy and abundant in love and forgives you all your sins for the sake of Jesus Christ, who lives within and among us and invites us to have life abundantly. Amen.
We do not know when Jesus will return,
but we know why.
We know that Jesus loves us in the here and now.
Jesus' ever-present love for us is the why.
Let us give thanks to God for God's eternal love in and through Jesus.
Thanks be to God.
May the grace of God, the love of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit at work in your lives be with you all.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of love, free us from our obsessive need to know what is unknowable, to have power over that which is beyond our control. Remove our fear of the unknown future and instill in us a peace so deep, a trust so profound that we cannot help but live lives of simple gratitude for all that you have given us and all that you have promised us. In Jesus' holy name, we pray. Amen. Please be seated. A reading from Daniel chapter 12, verses 1 through 3 and 5 through 13. One in human form came to Daniel and said, "At that time, Michael, the great prince, the protector of your people, shall arise. There shall be a time of anguish, such as never occurred since nations first came into existence. But at that time, your people shall be delivered. Everyone is found written in the book. Many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Then I, Daniel, looked, and two others appeared, one standing on this bank of the stream and one on the other. One of them said to the man clothed in linen who was upstream, 'How long shall it be until the end of these wonders?' The man clothed in linen who was upstream raised his right hand and his left hand towards heaven. And I heard him swear by the one who lives forever that it would be for a time, two times, and a half time, and that when the shattering of the power of the holy people came to an end, all these things would be accomplished. I heard, but could not understand. So I said, 'My Lord, what shall be the outcome of these things?' He said, 'Go your way, Daniel, for the words are to remain secret and sealed until the time of the end. Many shall be purified, cleansed, and refined, but the wicked shall continue to act wickedly. None of the wicked shall understand, but those who are wise shall understand. From the time that the regular burnt offering is taken away and the abomination that desolates is set up, there should be 1,290 days. Happy are those who persevere and attain the 1,335 days. But you, go your way and rest. You shall rise for your reward at the end of these days." The word of the Lord.
At this time, I'm going to invite the children who are here to come on up front. Let's spend some time together. Make room for all. Scoot back. We got a big group this morning. Let's scoot back and get everybody in here. Come on in. Come on in. There you go. Nice. Okay. Do you have school tomorrow?
No.
No. Do you know why you don't have school tomorrow?
It's Labor Day.
It's Labor Day. What in the world is Labor Day? Yes. Why we don't have school on Labor Day? Labor Day is a day set aside to honor or give thanks for all people who work. That's kind of cool, huh? Set this day aside to give thanks for people who work. I brought some things today. You tell me who might be the worker using what I have in my bag. A cook, yes, a cook. How about
a painter?
Yeah.
A hammer.
Well, it is a hammer, but who would use it? A worker. What kind of worker?
Construction
worker. Sure. Yeah.
Telephone.
It's not a telephone. A teacher might use that. Who else might use it? Is this a It's a calculator. Who else might use it?
Us.
Us. Scientist.
People.
Banker. Okay. Lots of people might want to use a calculator to help their math skills so they get the answer right and they know exactly what they're doing. So these are tools that some people use to work. And these are the kinds of people, along with many others, who we would honor tomorrow and give thanks for. Did you know that you also work? Do you have a job? No. What kind of work might you do? Do you have chores at home?
Yes.
Okay, is that work?
No.
Do you have things that are assigned to you in class, like line leader or cleanup crew or aid of some sort? So that's work you have in your school classrooms. When I was a kid, one of my chores was to keep my room clean, and my mom would come and inspect it. And so if I really, really didn't want to clean it, guess what I would do? I would put things under the bed, I'd put it in the closet and then shut the closet door. Or I might just bring it off the top of my dresser and put it into the drawer and shut the drawer.
Oh, I know.
It was fast, but was it accurate? No, but she didn't see it. Yeah, I hid it and she didn't see it, did she? She didn't know.
But you shouldn't lie.
I didn't lie. I just did it my way. All right, Mir, I'm going to read to you what the Bible says about doing work. Work at everything you do with all your heart. Work as if you were working for the Lord, not for human masters. Work because you know that you will finally receive as a reward what the Lord wants you to have. You, in your work, are serving the Lord Jesus. Do you ever think of that when you're cleaning your room or when you're doing the line leader thing at school, that you're actually working for God in that moment? Do you ever think that? No. Well, my friends, I'm going to encourage you the next time that you do your chores or you do your work for your teacher at school, remember you're not doing it for them, your mom or your teacher. You're doing it for God. What's one way you can remember that you're doing your work for God when you do your cleaning up and your making of your bed and your dusting of the dresser? You could pray. That's absolutely right. What else could you do?
Coffee.
Okay. Is there something else? Anything? Here's what I would do. This is what I would do. I could pray. Yes, I could do that too. Here's what, if I'm dusting the dresser, before I actually wipe away all that dust, I could draw the sign of the cross into the dust and then clean the dresser. I could shut my closet door with all that stuff inside, and I could draw the sign of the cross over the door. I could do that too. Whatever you choose to do, remember, Labor Day is for those we can honor to give thanks for their work, and you are one of those. Give thanks to God that you have the ability to work and can serve Him in doing it. Let's stand up and have a prayer. All right, can you grab my hand, honey? Thank you. Lord Jesus, thank you for coming to be our servant. Help us to remember that when we work, we are serving you. In your name we pray. Amen.
From now on, when I leave clothes lying around, I'm going to leave them in the shape of a cross on the floor. So that... What's she going to do now, right? She gave me the idea. So you can learn things in a children's sermon with the messages here. Let's pray. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This is the last sermon in our 5-week sermon series on Daniel. It's the last of our summer sermon series. And next week, we go back into the narrative lectionary. This narrative lectionary will begin again in Genesis. It will go through to Revelation by May, and it will follow the story of Jesus through Luke. So you have that to look forward to. By the way, if you want to know what those readings are in advance, you can follow along. There are some printed lectionaries on the information desk. I invite you to pick one of those up, especially if you're involved in the Tuesday Bible studies. It's a great way to kind of track with the readings as we go through that. So, well, as I said, this is the last sermon in this series on Daniel, and I have to say that I really enjoyed preaching from the first part of Daniel. You know, the part that I referred to as the children's story section of Daniel. But I have not really enjoyed preaching on the apocalyptic stories of Daniel. Last week, I was not that happy with my sermon. You know, it was more of a lecture than a sermon, so I apologize about that. I did a lot of explaining and interpreting, but there wasn't much in my sermon last week that was applicable to our present-day lives. At least that's the way I felt. I don't know if you felt that way. Now, here's my problem. It was good. Well, thank you. Thank you. That's we pay her to say that. So. Well, here's my problem, though. Today's story is yet another apocalyptic revelation, and this one is even worse. I mean, maybe you noticed it. A time, half a time, what is it? A time, two times, and half a time. Beforehand, the reader said, yeah, what am I doing? How should I even, what does this mean? And so I said, you'll figure it out. So there's a lot in here. Men dressed in white, obscure time references, lots of instructions about keeping it quiet and secret. I think this is even more complicated than last week's because this revelation, this vision, really began in chapter 10, and we've only read one chapter of it, chapter 12. So it's complicated. So what is a preacher to do? That is exactly the question I commiserated with my Tuesday Bible study about. And we came up with a couple of ideas of what I could do that I thought were really good. You know, there is this theme in Daniel for 11th hour rescues. You know, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are rescued from the fiery furnace. Daniel is rescued from the lion's den. So we had this great idea. Call Katie at 11 o'clock on Saturday night and have her preach for you. Wouldn't that be a great illustration of Daniel? Unfortunately, Katie got wind of this. She turned off her phone, ruining a perfectly good illustration. So she blocked my number, apparently. So on behalf of Katie, I apologize for her for ruining what would have been a great illustration. In all seriousness today, I am not going to try to explain the entire passage as I tried to do last week. Instead, I'm going to try and summarize the message of the whole book of Daniel using the dominant image of hope that we find in Daniel, which is most clearly articulated in our passage today. Now, before I get to that, I want to make a few preliminary comments. In the very first week of this sermon series, I suggested that Daniel was really an instruction book about how to be faithful as a Jew living under foreign rule, right? How to be faithful as a Jew living under foreign rule. Both instruction, really, and I should have added encouragement. Encouragement. And one of the primary ways that Daniel encourages his readers to persist and have courage in this situation is by offering them an alternative hope to the hope that was offered by those foreign powers, right? The hope in that case was just to assimilate, just go along with what everybody else is doing and not go through the persecution of trying to be different. Daniel wants to offer a better vision of hope.
In many ways, the book of Daniel is for all those people who've ever lamented about the state of the world, wondering when God is going to intervene, right? Wondering how we are to navigate life in this complicated, challenging world that we live in, desperate to know how we are supposed to live. As desperate as we might feel about the state of the world today, Daniel is writing at a time when the threat to life and faith was absolute. Life and death. That's an important thing to remember, because while much of Daniel seems like a children's story, these things are fundamental and essential to the future of Israel and foundational to our faith as Christians. So in the book of Daniel, the dominant image of hope is resurrection. And believe it or not, we've heard many resurrection stories already in Daniel. We haven't really called them resurrection stories, but that's really what they are. I mean, think about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I referred to this earlier as an 11th hour rescue, but that's not quite right, you know? They weren't rescued before being thrown into the fire. They were thrown into the fire. They were in there with the flames. They could feel the heat. And only then are they rescued. It's a resurrection story. Daniel, same thing, right? Daniel doesn't get a last-minute reprieve. He is condemned and thrown into the lion's den, and only then is he rescued. It's a resurrection story. And last week, you heard the story of Daniel's apocalyptic vision of the one like a human being coming on the clouds of heaven. Christians have long associated this story with the second coming of Christ and the resurrection of the dead at the end of time. For good reason. It's a resurrection story. It's a resurrection image. Daniel has been presenting stories of resurrection from the very beginning. And in today's passage, he gives us the most clear articulation of resurrection yet. Many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt. This, in fact, is the only reference in the Old Testament to bodily resurrection that is not a metaphor. I mean, there are lots of things that we read resurrection into in the Old Testament. Jonah, right? That's a metaphor of resurrection. But this is the only clear, direct reference to resurrection in the Old Testament. Now, in a full hour, I might lecture about how this vision of resurrection fits into this whole, apocalyptic vision. But today, I'm just going to focus on resurrection as the climax of this vision and as the substance of hope for Daniel in the whole book as he's writing. So for Daniel, the hope of resurrection is the natural conclusion of the promises of God to Israel. In the covenant of Sinai, Israel is told that if they keep the covenants, if they live by the values that God has placed before them in the Ten Commandments, they will be blessed. Daniel takes that promise seriously, even though the reality is just the opposite. The reality of Israel in that day is that they are being persecuted and killed precisely because of their faithfulness to the covenant. It's a contradiction. How is it possible that the promises of God in the covenant can be true and Israel can suffer? Not be blessed, but suffer because of their faithfulness. Daniel's conclusion is that God will keep his promise, even to those who are killed for their faithfulness. And resurrection is the way in which Daniel imagines or projects those promises as one day being fulfilled. As Daniel imagines the resurrection, it includes both blessing and curse, right? The blessing is everlasting life for those who are faithful, and the curse is shame and everlasting contempt for those who do not keep the covenant. This is important for Daniel, for the audience that he's writing to, because on the one hand, he wants to comfort them for having lost loved ones, for being faithful. They can trust in the promises of the resurrection. But he also wants to encourage them to remain faithful in the face of persecution and pressure. So it works in both ways, comfort and encouragement. Now, while Daniel's message of resurrection is a kind of faithful projection of the hope that is in God's promises, Christ's resurrection turns Daniel's projection into a tangible example of God's faithfulness to those promises and the first fruits of the resurrection that we will share with him. Christ makes this projection a tangible promise. Christ is the resurrection and the life. Christ is the fulfillment of this projection by Daniel in a way that Daniel could never even have imagined. Secondly, in the promise of the resurrection in this final vision, there is no happily ever after, right? Instead, the ending is as yet unwritten and unknown. There's a kind of uncertainty about it. Unlike the previous resurrection stories that we read in Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, Daniel in the lion's den, we know how those end, right? It's all good. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego get out in the end. Daniel gets out in the end. Even the one like a human being coming with the clouds, we know that eventually all dominion over the nations and kingdoms will be granted to him. There's a happy ending there. We don't get that in this final vision. In this story, instead, we are told that the words are to remain secret and sealed until the time of the end. In other words, how things turn out is ultimately not in our hands. We don't get the luxury of knowing the future and exactly how it unfolds or what our place will be in that. The only thing we can control, according to Daniel, is how we live in the circumstances in which we find ourselves in this moment. But in Christ, we do have a glimpse of the future. We do know the future in one important respect, and that is that it looks like Jesus. The resurrection is the only future we need to worry about, and God has made that much clear. The promise is Christ and resurrection. And finally, for Daniel, the hope of the resurrection is not a passive hope. It is an active hope. The message is not, you know what, the world is a mess and there's not much we can do about it, so just relax and wait. Eventually, hopefully, God will come and he's going to fix the mess, right? That is not Daniel's message. Rather, Daniel's message is a call to faith and courage in the face of challenging times, trusting in the promises that will one day become a reality. It's a call to living into the hope that God has promised in a way that makes that hope, even now, a living, tangible reality. This is not unlike what we find in passages of the Gospels. All of the Gospels include passages like this. But Jesus will say things like this from Luke's Gospel. I'll read the context here. Once Jesus was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God was coming, and he answered, "The kingdom of God is not coming with things that can be observed, nor will they say, 'Look, here it is,' or 'There it is.' For in fact, the kingdom of God is among you. The kingdom of God is within our reach. It can become a reality in us as God works in and through us. That is not a passive hope. It is a participatory, active hope in which we are part of what God is doing in the world. It requires faith that God is active and at work in the world and in us. And it requires courage and endurance not to lose faith and give up in the face of challenges. The good news of an active hope is that it makes it a hope that's more than just a hope for me, right? By living into hope in this active way, hope becomes tangible for others, something they can see in us, or touch in us, or live into with us. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Let's stand and sing.
I invite you to profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in God's power and mercy, we pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. Holy God, we know that all things must end. Remind us that your love transcends time, space, and all that is, and that you will never leave us, come what may. Give us joyful anticipation of the time when we will dwell in unending communion with you. God of mystery, we know that heaven and earth will pass away, but until such time, remind us that you have charged us with the care and preservation of creation. Let us enjoy the beauty of the natural world for as long as we live and strive to keep it for future generations to enjoy. God of mystery,
we lift our prayers
We know that nations and regimes and political parties will pass away, but in the here and now, make us to be responsible for the decisions of those we elect and hold them accountable to your call to justice for all people. God of mystery,
we lift our prayers to you.
We know that suffering will pass away, but for those experiencing illness, injury, trauma, addiction, and all forms of pain in the here and now, send your healing spirit and guide those who care for them. We also pray for those listed in Promising News who have asked for prayer. Prayers from the congregation are now invited, either aloud or from your hearts. God of mystery,
we lift our prayers to you.
We know that all human endeavors and creations will pass away, but in our daily living today, enrich us with the wonderful works of creativity, acts of selflessness, and other signs of your inspiration all around us. God of mystery,
we lift our prayers to you.
On this Labor Day weekend, we thank you for the gift of work, whether that be toiling in our garden, studying hard in school, working with the public, at a computer, or in a factory. We appreciate life and the ability to work. Continue to improve working conditions and establish fair living wages so that all people may thrive. God of mystery,
we lift our prayers to you.
We know so many saints who have passed away before us. Make us grateful for their lives and examples of faith, and help us to provide that same example to those still unborn. God of mystery,
we lift our prayers to you.
Confident in your life-living love, we lift these prayers and all those in our hearts into your loving care. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share that sign of peace.
our gifts and offerings. Get my wife.
My heart is filled with thankfulness to Him who bore my pain, who plumbed the depths of my disgrace and gave me life again.
Source of all, we offer with thankful hearts and joyful hands this small portion of your generosity toward us. Accept these gifts as a sign of our love for you and for all that you have created. Use them for the sake of all in need, material and immaterial things, according to your will. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And let us pray as our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus, who promises us our reward at the end of our days, calls us in the here and now to this table of grace and mercy. Come with your brothers and sisters in Christ and be nourished on his body and blood, that all might be strengthened for the journey. I invite the congregation to be seated. The blood of Christ is poured out for you.
blood of Christ poured out for you. The blood of Christ is poured out for you.
And now, having been fed by the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, please rise and sing Hear the Call of the King.
Hear the call.
At this table, we gather with all your saints, past and present, with those who gather in congregations around the world, and with our homebound who will receive by home communion. Renew us in the gift of your body and blood, that we may provide for those who are poor, pray for those in need, fast from self-indulgence, and above all, that we may find our treasure in the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May the Lord who delivers you from all that ensnares you keep you in his care now and always. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh, when the saints go marching in.
Hallelujah. Go now to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.